Okay, let's continue. So, ang idea natin is on the representative. So, when we say representative of a population kasi, ibig sabihin, dapat majority, iisa yung nagiging idea. At madedetermine lang natin if it's the majority, kung marami yung magre-represent dun sa population na yon. At yung lima, or sabihin mo ng sampo, marami na yon sa qualitative research. Hindi yun enough to really say na they are representing the ideas and the experiences of the entire population. So isa yun sa limitation ng qualitative research. Naka-focus kasi siya sa small group of people that we really cannot say na they are what the entire population is really thinking or experiencing. So for example, another example sa kalapakuhan ulit, you want to know kung meron bang naka-establish na program for trash segregation. Talaga bang may naka-establish na program, na-implement ba ito, at ito ba ay na-enforce ng barangay kalapakuhan. So pag nag-interview ka ng sampo, yung sampong yun sinabi wala, is it really enough to say na wala talagang program for trash segregation, e 10,000 ang population mo. So less than 1% yung tinanong mo, tapos yun yung magiging conclusion mo. So it's not gonna be enough. So for you to do that, kailangan mag-conduct ka ng mas maraming, ng survey sa mas maraming tao para mas maraming ideas, mas maraming experiences yung makukuha mo to really say that they represent the entire population. And then of course, another limitation of qualitative research is that they really require skills para doon sa researcher, doon sa mag-a-administer ng interview. And unfortunately, hindi ganun karami yung tao who have the training and the skills and the expertise to really do that. So hindi lahat talaga ng tao can do a qualitative research. Most of the time, what we are doing is quantitative research, and then yung iba, nagmi-mixed research, combination of qualitative and quantitative. Pero yung ang focus talaga is 100% qualitative. Walang masyadong, or konti yung taong gumagawa nito because they fear that they don't have the skills or the training to really do it properly. Okay, so now let's go to the different kinds of qualitative research. We actually have 5 kinds of qualitative research. So we have the phenomenology, ethnography, we have the action research, case study, at saka yung narrative na kind of qualitative research. So now let's focus on phenomenology or phenomenological method. So when we say phenomenology, coming from the word phenomenon, we are trying to explore or have a deeper understanding about a certain phenomenon. Okay? So yung mga trending na nangyayari ngayon, yung mga issues na nangyayari ngayon, they are part of a phenomenon. Okay? So you want to focus on them. So you are going to be observing them. Balik tayo dun sa example ng cancer patients. So you just want the phenomenon of people suffering from cancer. And you just want to explore ano yung experiences nila, ano yung nagiging difficulties nila. So you are an outsider. You're trying to have a deeper understanding about this group of people. Hindi ka cancer patient, wala kang family that is a cancer patient, pero you want to have an understanding about their experiences. So you are an outsider trying to look inside their experiences. That is what we call as phenomenology. Okay? It is actually different from the idea of ethnography. When we say ethnography kasi, you also want to focus on a group of people. You also want to have a deeper understanding about this group of people. Pero in ethnography, it's not enough for you to be an outsider trying to have an understanding about them. In ethnography kasi, for you to have a really deeper understanding about your target group of people, it requires the researcher to really immerse himself doon sa kanilang group of people. So for example, ang target mo ay the Aitas in Zambales, a tribe of Aitas living in Zambales. So if you will be doing a phenomenology, i-observe mo lang sila. You will just take note ano yung ginagawa nila every day. Pero pagdating sa ethnography kasi, hindi enough na ino-observe mo lang sila. You have to be one of them. So ibig sabihin, i-immerse mo yung sarili mo sa kanila. Matutulog ka dun sa tinutulugan nila. Kakainin mo yung kinakain nila. Pag gumising sila ng 4 a.m., kung ano yung suot nila, yun din yung susuotin mo. Kung ano yung ginawa nila from morning until night, yun at yun din yung gagawin mo. So, in ethnography, you will become one of them. You will immerse yourself in the culture and the everyday lives of your respondents para yung understanding mo about their beliefs, about their experiences, mas malalim. Sa phenomenology kasi, you're just observing. So, nakaupo ka lang doon, pinapanood mo sila kung anong ginagawa nila. You can ask them questions. Which is different from ethnography kasi ikaw mismo, ginagawa mo kung ano yung ginagawa nila. At the longer your immersion is, or the longer you stay with them, the longer that you try to become one of them, mas maganda yung magiging result ng research, ethnography research mo. Okay? Sabi dito, immerse the researcher as a subject for extended periods of time. Okay? So, mas maganda kasi yung understanding about a certain group of people. So, usually, ang ethnography, they really do it for, ito yung mga tribal groups na may ibang mga paniniwala, may mga ibang beliefs. Bakit nga ba sila may mga pamahiin na ganito? Nagkakaroon sila ng understanding through what we call as ethnographic model. So, syempre, hindi kayo pwedeng maggawa ng ethnography during this time. Kasi hindi kayo pwedeng ma-immerse in your group of people. So, most of the time, ang gagawin ninyo ay phenomenology. Okay? And then we have, ito, sabi niya, ethnography is the study of people in naturally occurring. So, bakit niya in-emphasize yung word or yung phrase na naturally occurring settings? It's because wala kang babaguhin doon sa everyday lives nila. Isisingit mo lang yung sarili mo doon. I-immerse mo lang yung sarili mo within the community. And it allows you to answer questions about social meanings. Ito yung mga paniniwala nila, cultures and traditions, mga rituals nila. And then of course, ordinary activities. Na hindi natin masyadong nakakapture kapag ang ginawa mo ay phenomenology. And then, of course, we have the narrative model. Narrative model is also used as, ang tawag nila dito ay historical research. Kasi usually ito yung, ang focus ay mga experiences ng mga tao during a certain period of time. So in Zambales, ano yung mga usual na periods na pinufocus? World War II, martial law, Mount Pinatubo, ayan, kasi syempre isa tayo dun sa mga devastated with the Mount Pinatubo eruption. So if we want to really have a deeper understanding ano yung fear na naramdaman ng mga tao dun, ano yung mga experiences nila, paano sila namili ng pagkain, do they have to evacuate, sila ba yung mga taong nasiraan ng livelihood or nasiraan ng bahay, that is a narrative model. Siguro 5 years from now, isa sa pinakamagandang research na gawin is a narrative model of the pandemic. Sana in 5 years from now, di ba, tapos na yung pandemic and we can go back to our old normal. And then you can have a comparison. Yung experiences ba ng people here in Zambales is during the quarantine, during the lockdown, is it the same or is it different dun sa experiences ng mga tao who are in Manila during that time. Kasi syempre, number of cases magkaiba, mas marami doon. So dapat mas mahigpit, very strict in compliance and implementation of the community lockdown sa kanila. So ano yung mga naging challenges nila? Ano yung mga na-experience nila? Sila ba yung nawalan ng trabaho? Sila ba yung mga gustong umuwi sa probinsya pero walang masakyan, so naglakad na lang. Kasi may mga ganong nabalita dati, di ba? So siguro 5 years from now or after the pandemic is over and when we are able to go back to our everyday lives, ayan, isa sa mga magiging popular at magandang i-pursue na research topic is a narrative of the experiences of people during the lockdown. So syempre, hindi naman ako, tayo naman lahat, we were not expecting it. And ano yung mga coping mechanisms natin, ano yung mga ginawa natin para hindi tayo mabagot sa loob ng bahay because we couldn't go out, kung meron bang mga na-depress, how did we, alam mo yun, binago natin yung everyday lives natin. So ayan, narrative for a historical research about it. Okay? Next is a case study. So case study is basically a comparison between two groups of people or pwedeng same group of people pero meron kang binago. So for example, I want to check if providing a reward will really increase the attendance of students online. So for example, ngayon, in-observe ko, ganito karami yung mga pumapasok ng student, ganito karami yung late, ganito karami yung hindi nag-a-attend ng online classes. And then I am going to make some changes in the situation. So for example, for those who were able to have a complete attendance, yung hindi late, talagang present, for the entire month of February, I will be giving a gift certificate from Jollibee worth 500 pesos. If it will be effective or not in increasing the motivation of students to attend online classes. So I'm going to observe for the entire month of February, is the attendance going to increase or not? So after the month of February, I will compare yung attendance ng January at yung attendance ng February. Nag-increase ba? Did it stay the same? O baka naman mas bumaba? Okay? So that is a case study. You are going to compare yung magiging observation mo or yung magiging result between groups of people who are experiencing different things dahil meron kang binago doon sa situation. Okay? So, it allows people to identify kung ano yung effective na solution for the subject. So, pag nakita kong wala namang nagbago in terms of attendance, ibig sabihin, hindi effective yung providing gift certificate from Jollibee in really increasing the online attendance. So, maaaring may ibang way or try to identify ano nga ba yung reason kung bakit mababa yung online attendance bago mag-provide ng possible solution. So that is a case study. And then the last one is an action research. Most people call it the participatory action research, and I will explain why later. So action research actually is a good kind of qualitative research kasi it really focuses on existing problems within the community. Yun ang focus niya. Kailangan makahanap ng solusyon doon sa mga problema na nararanasan natin within the community. Okay? Kaya ang first part of an action research is always to identify a community problem. Okay? And then pag na-identify mo na yung community problem, for example, in Kalapakuan, isa sa community problem natin, flooding, you will conduct a research about possible solutions. So mag-search ka sa ibang bansa, sa ibang lugar, within Zambales or within the Philippines or ibang bansa. Ano yung mga naging paraan nila or solution nila para doon sa flooding? And then you will come up with possible solutions and mamimili ka doon sa nahanap mong possible solutions. Ano yung applicable within our community? Applicable in a way na kaya natin gawin, available yung materials, okay? The same geographic location, ibig sabihin pareho yung na-experience natin na taon-taon, may bagyo, ganyan. So, from there, you are going to come up with your plan. And yung plan na yon, kaya siya naging participatory action research, is because hindi lang siya i-implement. Ikaw mismo, as a researcher, you have to participate in the implementation of the action research. Okay? So sabi niya dito, it involves community members. Specifically, yung researcher, ikaw mismo dapat sa iyong magsisimula yung implementation ng plan na yon. So for example, ang naging strategy mo or possible solution mo is the implementation of segregation of trash. So ikaw mismo, magsisegregate ka ng trash mo and then i-encourage mo yung other people to start segregating their trash para makita talaga kung merong effect yung naging solution mo doon sa existing problem. So ito yung process of doing participatory action research. So you always start with thinking. The thinking part is, sabi ko nga, ito yung identifying problems or issues in the community. And then from there, you will start a theory. You will research possible solutions. Ano yung pwedeng ma-adapt within your community. And then you will start planning. Paano natin ipapatupad itong segregation of trash? Siyempre, kailangan i-inform mo muna yung mga tao. You have to raise awareness. And then you have to come up with a plan kung paano mamomonitor yung implementation tsaka kung paano mai-enforce na susunod yung mga tao doon sa plano yon. At kailangan ikaw, as a researcher, you are a part of this planning and you are a part of this doing. So, hindi pwedeng ikaw ay nag-o-observe lang. Kailangan ikaw mismo gumagawa. So, yan yung di ba hinahanap natin sa mga public officials natin. Mas gusto natin pag nakikita natin na sila ay mismong hands-on na ginagawa yung mga pagbabago within our community. Ayaw natin yung puro salita lang tapos wala namang gawa. So, kaya siya tinawag na participatory action research. It really dictates that you participate in the planning and in the doing. At pag na-implement mo na siya, i-evaluate mo siya ngayon. Effective ba siya? In some way, nabawasan ba yung pagsisegregate ng trash, nabawasan ba niya na nagkakaroon ng mga kanal na barado? And because of that, nabawasan ba yung flooding? If it's effective and if it's not, then the cycle will continue. Pag hindi siya effective, then you have to come up with ideas. Bakit hindi nag-work? Ano yung naging problem pa ulit? And then you have to start theorizing ulit, and then planning, and then doing ulit. So paulit-ulit yung cycle until such a time that we can come up with a good plan that will really solve the problem. Okay? So yan yung five kinds of tawag dito, qualitative research. So now, let's try to go back to our essential questions. Anyone from the class who would like to answer the first essential question?
What is qualitative